would you guys please stand and join us in worship?
Strong going. on my lips.
Come on, you know it.
You will be faithful.
To be gathered together as a people, isn't it? Worshiping God. I want to bring to light a passage out of Philippians chapter 3. It says this: we rely on what Christ Jesus has done for us. We put no confidence in human effort, though I could have confidence in my own effort if anyone could. That's Paul talking. Paul says, indeed, if others have reason for confidence in their own efforts, I have even more. He says, I was circumcised when I was 8 days old. I'm a pure-blooded citizen of Israel and a member of the tribe of Benjamin, a real Hebrew, if there ever was one. I was a member of the Pharisees who demanded the strictest obedience to the Jewish law. I was so zealous that I harshly persecuted the church. And as for righteousness, I obeyed the law without fault. He says, I once thought that these things were valuable, but now I consider them as worthless because of what Christ has done. Yes, everything else is worthless when compared with the infinite value of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. For his sake, I have discarded everything else, counting it all as lost, so that I could gain Christ and become one with him. I no longer count on my own righteousness through obeying the law, but rather I become righteous through faith in Christ. For God's way of making us right with him, with himself, depends on faith. I want to know Christ and experience the mighty power that raised him from the dead. I want to suffer with him. I want to share in his death so that one way or another, I will experience the resurrection from the dead. Church, I don't know about you, but there are so many times in my life where I place stock and value in the things that I can do. There are so many times in my life where I place so much value in how good of a husband I am, how good I am at my job, how many times I read my Bible in a week, how long my prayers are, how I treat my friends, my family. I put so much value in those things, and I tend to forget that my value and the most important thing to me should be in the fact that I know Christ Jesus as Lord. And I want to encourage you, if there's anyone here in this room who struggles with that, who struggles with having the focus of your life be all these other things, can I invite you for a moment to consider what you're doing, to consider the fact that the most important thing that you can do is to know Jesus as your Lord, okay? And in response to that, can we just sing praises to Jesus? Can we sing praises to the Lord who invites us to draw near to him? Let's do that this morning. Sing this.
Oh, my words fall short. I've got nothing new. How could I express all my gratitude? I could sing these songs as I often do. Every song must end, and you never do.
Come on, we sing this.
So I throw up my hands and praise you again and again. It's all that I have is a hallelujah, hallelujah. I know it's not much, I'm nothing.
That's right.
I will worship.
I'm nothing else fit for my King, except for a heart singing hallelujah. Oh, we give you praise.
and dominions, all powers and positions. know who you are. God, we know that you are good. We know that you are sovereign. We know that you are holy. There's no one else like you in all the heavens and all the earth, Lord. You alone are holy and worthy of our praise. And God, we are grateful. We are honored to be in your presence today. God, thank you that we get to dwell with you. Thank you that your spirit lives in us. That God, we have access to you because of your son, Jesus, his work on the cross and his resurrection. Lord, we give you the praise. We give you the honor and you the glory. In Jesus' name, everybody said, amen. Praise God. It's good to worship. Harvest family, you guys can go ahead and have a seat. It's great to worship together. It's great to praise him and his house. My name is Larry Geisler. I get to serve here as the pastor of Harvest Students and Harvest Young Adults. We're just grateful to be here today. If this is your first time at Harvest Bible Chapel, welcome. We're glad that you're here. If you're looking to find out some more about our church, or you have questions that you would like answered, you just want to meet somebody, I'll be out in our lobby. We have a big welcome set up. It's hard to miss. Please come say hi before you leave. I'd love to answer any of those questions. Just figure out how our church can serve you today. So please do that before you go ahead and walk out of here. For everyone, we want you to know it's our goal as a staff, as a church, to make sure that we're all becoming better disciples of Jesus, that we learn more and more each day what it means to follow him, that we continue on that trail of being a follower of Jesus. And some of the ways that we do that, just a few out of the many, are found on the Church Center app. So it's our new app for the church. You can open that up, or you can scan a QR code on a seat in front of you. And what you're going to find there is a place where you can fill out our Connect card and check in, which means that when we see that you're not checking in for a while, we can reach out to you and say, hey, man, hey, we miss you. We know it's important to gather together and worship together. So please let us know that you're here. And as well, we want to be praying for the things that you're praying for. So the things that are on your heart and on your mind, the things that you're walking through, if you're praying, we want to be praying. And so our church staff is going to get those, and we'll be lifting those up to the Lord. And we want to celebrate when God answers our prayers. So please just submit your prayer request there so we can pray alongside of you. And speaking of discipling and what it means to be a disciple, one of the greatest discipleship ministries of our church that some people might not know about is Harvest Christian Academy. If you didn't know, we have an entire school, preschool through 12th grade, in our Elgin campus, HCA Harvest Christian Academy. And so if you're somebody who is looking for a solid, strong Christian education for your child and you want to learn a little more about that, we have representatives from HCA out in our lobby today. So please don't leave without talking to them and hearing how it is that HCA leverages their opportunity to spend every day with the kids that they teach to be disciples of Jesus. Another way that we've seen discipleship happening in our church just a few weeks ago is we had our Women on Mission Conference. Anyone here a part of the Women on Mission Conference? Okay, amen. So it was an awesome, awesome event where we had over 500 ladies in our church come and gather and worship together, sit under strong and sound biblical teaching, and be with Jesus, which we pray leads to a lifetime of being with Jesus, living with Jesus. And so we just want to take a look at some of the highlights from that weekend. You can take a look at the screen.
To know and enjoy God is to know the heart and the character of God. To be rooted in God's word is really to know and enjoy him.
But you guys, that's the whole point of what we're doing here. It's knowing him. It's continuing to live our lives in him.
Stop striving. I see us anxiously pursuing the Lord when he says, my yoke is easy and my burden is light. What is heavy is our sin and our legalism and our self-righteousness. So we need to give it up and just be the branch.
Awesome. Yeah, praise God for the way that he used that, and we pray that the fruit of that just continues to last and impacts our church for years and years to come. Now, we wanted to shift our focus to our giving this month, and we have a special offering for the month of April. We've done one of these for quite a while now, and in the past, you might have seen that we've done some special offerings that pertain to our church family. We've done offerings that have to do with our benevolence ministries and different things going on in our church. So you see there's a little graphic here. We've done our church family and gave to things in the church, and that's wonderful, and we praise God for that. Today, we want to shift our attention to not just in the people in our church, but who is not a part of our church and our community that would benefit from our giving. Specifically, Christian ministries that are doing gospel work in very great areas of need. And so there's three of them that our offerings are going to this month. I want to tell you a little bit about them. The first one is called Naomi's House. Naomi's House is an organization that helps women who have been sexually exploited or been trafficked in some way and need help. Need to get back on their feet, need restoration in their lives. And Naomi's House helps them with that and gives them the hope of the gospel. Another one is Clear Brook, which is right in our area. And this provides services for children and adults with different disabilities. And they bring quite a few people to our In His Image ministry each month. The last one is Life Choices. Life Choices is a pregnancy care center to help people with their pregnancies and pursuing things like adoption and just having babies and providing free ultrasounds and things like that. So we're really grateful for what each of these organizations are doing. We want to give to help them continue to pursue what God's called them to do. And also, if you're interested in learning about these, maybe volunteering in some of these ministries and serving the Lord there, as you leave, Life Choices and Naomi's House have two tables set up in the lobby. Please go and learn about what they're doing and see how you might be able to be a part of how God is moving in people's lives through those ministries. So the ways you can give are on the screen. You can also give to the special offering specifically. On the way out, there will be ushers at the door with some bags you can give to, but you can also give online and to the special or your weekly offering that way as well. But we're going to take some time to pray for each of those ministries, for this offering, and for our gathering this morning. Would you join me? Father, we come to you humbly, recognizing that you are great and you are mighty. And God, we're just humbly coming to you and asking you to do something with what we give to you. God, you've given us so much. And God, we are grateful. We're cheerful in that we get to give to the work that you're doing. And so as we give to these three wonderful organizations that you have planted in our community to make an impact for the gospel, Lord, we pray that you would bless them, that you would give them favor in all the things that they've set out to do. That God, we know these are visions, these are missions that you have put on their heart. And God, we want to see these things flourish. We want to see lives changed because of what you're doing in them. And so, Lord, would you just allow this offering to be a part of that, to be a blessing to them, that your work might continue in these areas. And God, we pray for this morning, we pray for Pastor Jeff as he's opening your word, as he's teaching us. God, we pray that your Holy Spirit would speak clearly and powerfully to us this morning. We pray for everyone here that you give us soft hearts, so you give us ears to hear what you have to say to us, that we'd be encouraged to continue following you, knowing you, living for you each day of our lives. So Lord, we give this all to you. We love you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, well, Harvest family, we're starting a brand new series today. We're starting a series on 1 Peter. So you can open up your Bibles to 1 Peter chapter 1. While you do that, why don't you stand up? Why don't you find somebody who is a brother or sister in your church family that you might not know yet, get to know them a little bit.
you have a Bible, I want to invite you to open it to 1 Peter chapter 1. 1 Peter chapter 1. A name you probably should know in modern Christian history is a woman named Rosaria Butterfield. Rosaria Butterfield was a lesbian professor at Syracuse University, and the reason I bring up the fact that she was a lesbian is that she was a real advocate for that particular way of life and was a resource for lots and lots of young people who were struggling with their identity and these sorts of things. She served very much as like the focal point at Syracuse University. She was the one that people would come to and would get advice and be ushered into the LGBTQ kind of world. And before this, she was often very opposed by some Christian people in the community. She used to get really bad letters, hate letters to her. One occasion, though, she got a letter. She either got hate letters or she got really, like, we think you're amazing letters, but very few in between, until she received one letter on one occasion from a couple. It was a pastor and his wife. And they said, we love your scholarship, love you, but we don't agree with the way that you view some of these things, and we'd love to have a dialogue with you about it, not a fight or anything, and could we do it over dinner at our house? We'd love to host you for dinner at our house. It'd be great. And she was studying some stuff about Christianity at the time and the history of the church and things, and so she thought, what a great way to learn that kind of thing. I'll go to their house. She ended up going to their house, and they had a great conversation, and they said, look, why don't we do this every week or frequently? And she came back, and she came back, and she came back, and eventually came to faith in Christ. That move, though, from being in the world that was being affirmed and celebrated by Syracuse University to being a Christian who now repudiates what she was, made her the target of all of her old friends. The people she used to love and spend all this time with all of a sudden turned their sights on her as now, instead of being one of the advocates, but one of the enemies. There are actually videos of Rosaria Butterfield going to other universities and standing up, as a Christian woman, standing up in front of a classroom or some gathered assembly of sorts that was put together by a campus group. She'd stand up in front of these groups, and the whole first three rows, when she stood up, would stand up, turn around, and just scream the whole time so she couldn't give any kind of address. She knew many of the people who were screaming. They used to be people that she spent an enormous amount of time with. That radical both transformation on her part, but also transformation of the society's view of a person, that was really, quite honestly, what the early church faced. Most of the people who came to faith in the early church, especially as the gospel went around kind of the Roman world, most of the people were Gentiles. They were people who were worshiping the emperor one day, celebrating idol feasts in their workplace, and then they come to faith in Christ, and because they want to remain faithful to Jesus, they abstain from the feast. They turn away from all of the things they once were, which led to them being kind of ostracized by the society at large. The people who used to love them now were like, you guys are the problem with the world. There's a wonderful book. If you ever like church history at all, but you're like, I don't want to get, reading history is as boring as reading history, you know, like, if you want to read a book, though, that's really engaging, but that gets into the history of the church, Bruce Shelley's book, Church History in Plain Language, is one of the best you could ever buy. In it, here's the way he describes the situation of the early church. He said, the more early Christians took their faith seriously, the more they were in danger of crowd reaction. Thus, simply by living according to the teachings of Jesus, the Christian was a constant, unspoken condemnation of the pagan way of life. It was not that the Christian went about criticizing and condemning and disapproving, nor was he consciously self-righteous and superior. It was simply that the Christian ethic in itself was a criticism of pagan life. For the pagan, every meal began with a liquid offering and a prayer to the pagan god. A Christian couldn't share in that. Most feasts and social parties were held in the precincts of a temple after sacrifice had been made, and the invitation was usually to dine at the table of some god. A Christian couldn't go to such a feast. Inevitably, when he refused the invitation to some social occasion, the Christian seemed rude or boorish or discourteous. The Christian fear of idolatry also led to difficulties in making a living. A mason might be involved in building the walls of a heathen temple, a tailor in making robes for a heathen priest, an incense maker in making incense for the heathen sacrifices. In short, the early Christian was almost bound to divorce himself from social and economic life of his time. If he wanted to be true to the Lord, he would abstain. This meant that everywhere the Christian turned, his life and faith were on display because the gospel introduced a revolutionary new attitude toward human life. Or in other words, sincerely following Jesus made you weird. It invited stink eye. You know what I mean by stink eye, right? It's what you get when you are driving on the road and the person doesn't really want to flip you off or anything, but so they just give you the side eye. Stink eye, like, I disapprove of you. It's not full-blown. We wouldn't say, okay, getting stink eye from the wider society is really persecuting. We wouldn't say that. But persecution is something that happens on a spectrum. Persecution can result in the murder of the people being persecuted, right? If you're a Christian and you're being persecuted, it might lead to, in parts of the world, to you actually being burned alive, as it has in the history of the Christian church. That's persecution. We call you a martyr. But it also might lead to you losing some business opportunities because you're not involved in the society at large in some ways. You feel like, I can't make a cake for that. It might mean that you lose some friends. And it might mean that everybody around you kind of looks with the stink eye at you because you don't fit in morally to the world. You have a whole set of rules that are not the rules of the society at large. They want you to live one way, you live the other way, and so they're like, what is wrong with you? You're weird. All of that is persecution. I bring this up because the book of 1 Peter was written to a congregation or congregations of people who were facing stink eye persecution. It hadn't gone full death yet. It would, by the way. But at the front end, this group of people were trying to figure out, how do we remain faithful to Christ when all of our friends think we're idiots? Because the easy thing to do would just be to involve ourselves in all the things the society has for us and just go through with it. You know, cross our fingers, pretend we don't really mean it. How do we live faithfully as Christian people in the midst of a society that doesn't value what we value? How do we remain following Jesus in that? Sound familiar? Which is why 1 Peter is a great book for people like us to study. Because it's exactly the kinds of things that are facing us right now in our society here in the Western world. Peter's going to write to encourage these guys just to keep going. That's basically what the whole book's about. Listen to the first two verses. This is we're only going to study two verses today. You'd think it'd be shorter, right? But we're going to, two verses, 1 Peter 1, 1 and 2. He says, Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to those who are elect exiles of the dispersion in Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia, according to the foreknowledge of God the Father and the sanctification of the Spirit for obedience to Jesus Christ and for sprinkling with his blood, may grace and peace be multiplied to you. In the New Testament, when these guys would write letters, usually at the very beginning of their letters, when they give these introductions, they kind of foretell what the whole book's about. And so in these two verses, you're actually going to get the whole argument of the book. In fact, I think that Peter makes the whole argument in the book in just two words. Why should you keep going in the midst of stink-eye persecution? Because you are elect exiles. You are elect exiles. So that's going to form our outline. I want to deal first with the question of what does it mean to be an exile? And then second, what does it mean to be elect? And why are these things so important for people like us facing stink-eye persecution, okay? This is going to be fun. I love this book. It's going to be absolutely fantastic. So look, let's deal with the first of those questions. What does it mean that we are exiles? Well, here's, again, the first verse of the passage. Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to those who are, there it is, elect exiles of the dispersion. If you're a Christian, you probably know something about this guy, right? Peter. Even if you're not, you probably might have been around the church at all. You probably heard something about Peter at some point. His story is fascinating, though. Like, if you go back and you just kind of retell it. First time he ever meets Jesus is he's a fisherman. He's in his boat, and Jesus is getting crowded on the shores of a lake. And he says to Peter, "Okay, can I get in your boat? Push off from the shore a little bit so I can finish teaching these people and not be like pushed into the sea." Sure. They push off a little bit of the shore. Jesus teaches from the boat, you know, sound carries over the water a little bit. It's not like they're far out. He finishes teaching and he immediately turns to Peter and doesn't say, "Hey, can we go back in?" He says, "Hey, let's go back out. Let's do some fishing." It's the middle of the day. Peter is like, "Look, this is not the right time for fishing. The fish are not out there. Okay. We were doing it all night, Jesus. We don't need to do some more now." But okay. They go back out. Jesus says, "Hey, put some nets over on this side." And, you know, Peter is just accommodating the master, the rabbi, the teacher at this point. They throw their nets out on one side, and all of a sudden the fish have decided that they want to get into the nets because that's like their home. And they pull in the nets and they fill the boat full of fish. They've never seen so much fish. They have to call their friends to get more boats around so they can fill those boats with fish. And somewhere along the line, Peter realizes that the guy in the boat with him is not an ordinary dude. So he turns to Jesus and he says, "Depart from me, for I'm a sinful man." Well, somewhere a little bit later, Jesus is walking by the shore and he says to Peter, "Peter," Simon is his name at that point, "Andrew," his brother, "come follow me." And the scriptures say that they left their nets and they followed him. In other words, they left behind everything that they had and they followed him. They're like, "Okay, look, if there's somebody we want to follow, it's a dude who's able to put fish in the boat without us fishing." He says, "I'll make you fishers of men, okay? I'm in." And they're fully committed. I mean, if you want to summarize one thing about Peter, that's probably what you'd say. Whatever Peter's into, he's into, man. He's the guy in the classroom who asks the question that everybody else is thinking but doesn't have the courage to raise their hands. He's the person who will do something, even if it makes him look like an idiot, because I gotta do it. Always know what Peter's feeling. He wears his emotions on his sleeve. You know people like this? Some of you are people. We're all part like people like this. Well, there's this scene where as Peter and the other disciples are following Jesus, Jesus says, "Listen, I want you to go out into to the other side of the lake. I'll meet you there later. I'm going to go up and pray on a mountainside or a hillside." Jesus goes up alone. He prays on the hillside, and then the disciples take off, but the wind comes up, and it's blowing against them, and they're rowing across the lake, but they're not getting anywhere. And now it's nighttime, so it's dark out. And along the top of the water comes Jesus just strolling along. Hey, guys. And they freak out. Ah, it's a ghost. And Jesus says, whoa, 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 don't be afraid. It's just me. And the rest of them settle down and just are in awe of looking at this guy walking on water. But Peter's like, cool, can I come out there with you? Yeah, come on. Like, listen, he's the guy who's willing to get out. Yeah, does he sink when he looks at the wind and the waves around him? Yeah. Jesus reaches out, pulls him back up and says, why did you doubt? But let's give him a little credit. He's the guy who's willing to go out and do these things. You can understand that when Jesus started saying at the end of his time with them, I mean, a few years of them following him, he started saying, by the way, where this is headed is I'm going to go to Rome, to Jerusalem, and they're going to kill me. Yes, I'm the Messiah, come to bring freedom, but the freedom comes through death. And not only that, but all of you guys, he says to all of these disciples, all of you guys are going to ditch me. You can understand why Peter, being the guy he is, who's always in 100% in whatever he's into, pulls Jesus aside afterwards and goes, look, I get it, man. I've lived with these guys, with you, for the last several years. And I'm telling you, I'm not sure I trust any of them. And when comes time for us to drop the gloves, I get it. Most of them are going to run away. Matthew, the tax collector, he's not sticking around. But I'm sticking around, Jesus. They could all leave you, Jesus, but not me. Oh, Peter. The rooster will crow after you've denied me three times. No way. Well, Jesus gets arrested. Peter follows at a distance. He's down over a fire. And there's people around, friends of the guards, who are looking at him suspiciously and saying, you were with that Jesus guy, right? No. A young girl. Nah, I'm pretty sure you were. Hey, no, I wasn't. Come on, man. We've never seen you before. You show up right now. He's up there. You're down here. Suspicious, right? And I got a friend who thinks you were with them. I don't know the man. Cue the rooster. If there is anybody in the history of the Christian church who is qualified to speak about giving up in the midst of persecution, it's Peter. So when stink eye persecution starts to face this church, this Peter, you can understand why it is. He's like, I've got something to share. You guys need to understand how it is that you can get through this, because I didn't. And here's what I wish I knew then, that I know now, that can get you through this. I'm an apostle of Jesus Christ, and I'm writing to those who are elect exiles of the dispersion. This is an interesting phrase, isn't it? This word, dispersion, is an Old Testament word. It basically means when a nation comes and they win against another, the nation of Bucknam, right? The kingdom of Bucknam, ruled by my benevolence, is going to conquer the kingdom of Harvest, right? I've arrayed my troops and I'm going to conquer the kingdom of Harvest. And I do, I win. And the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to find all the smarty smarts in the group here, and I'm going to pick you up, all the potential leaders and the real leaders, especially if you're young. I'm going to pick you up, and I'm going to take you back to Bucknam land so I can indoctrinate you in the ways of Bucknam. In this way, I'm basically cutting off your future from you. I mean, it's a kind of a brilliant tactic, to be honest with you. This is what you did. This is the way that you acted once you won victories in those days. And so you know this. The Babylonians come and they defeat Israel and they take up all the smart people, Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego. They take them back to Babylon and they indoctrinate them. We call people who are far from their home, longing to return, part of the dispersion. They belong in Jerusalem, but they live scattered throughout the whole world. What's interesting about this is that Peter, when he says this, exiles of the dispersion, this refers in the Old Testament to the people of Israel who are longing to go back to Jerusalem, their home. But when Peter uses it of Christians, he's saying, oh, we have a home too. It's not the Jerusalem in the Middle East. It's the New Jerusalem. And we live all over the place. These places, Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Bithynia. This is like states. We live in Indiana and Wisconsin and Illinois and... And we long for home. What home? That heavenly one, man. And in the meantime, we're exiles. Meaning we're weird. We're like Daniel in Babylon. We're odd. We're strangers in a strange land. And strangers stick out. You know that, right? One of the blessings of my life is I've had the opportunity to travel quite a bit. My mother used to say to me, for people who don't have anything, you sure? I'll say the actual thing she said. For people who don't have a pot to pee in, you sure travel a lot. And she was right. We had an opportunity to go all over the place. I've been to Thailand. Led some mission teams to Thailand, have gotten to know a number of Thai people and people from Laos. One of the things in Thailand that you should know if you visit is that you should never show the bottom of your feet to anyone. It's actually quite hateful. So when I first arrived in Thailand, nobody told me this. And like a lot of the guys in the room, you know, when you're sitting down and you're relaxing, if there's a table in front of you, whoop, you put your feet right up there, you know? Or you might cross your legs, you know, the guy way, like this, so that the bottom of your shoes are, you know, or your feet are evident to all. I remember going into the first meeting, you know, I was the honored pastor. And I sat down and I immediately crossed my legs. And everyone in the room went, and I was like, what did I do? This dear woman who was part of the ministry there, her name was Noi, she grabbed my arm and goes, stop it. I'm like, what am I doing? Put your leg down. Okay. Halfway through the meeting, I put my foot up on the chair. She's like, what are you doing? Everybody gasped. After the meeting, I said, why were you pulling my arm? She said, you don't show your feet to people. It's like really, really hateful. Oh, yeah, that's not a thing where we are. When I was in New Zealand, living there, one of the things, the native people of New Zealand are Maoris, okay? And John, I'm going to ask you to come up here for just a second. The Maori people, when they greet somebody, especially the men, by the way, the South Pacific men, very large, strong, oftentimes have tattoos all over. Have you guys ever seen the haka? We're not doing the haka. Okay. The haka is this dance, this war dance that they'll do. And their tongues go way out, right? And you, like, honestly, they'll do it before a sporting event. And before, I'm like, when I see it, I'm like, yeah, we're quitting. They're going to win this. No question about it, right? But if they greet you, if a Maori greets you, a man, this is what they do. You ready, brother? Come over here. Come over here. Come over here.
What are you doing?
Thank you.
You're welcome.
They press noses, again, like a very large man will grab you if you're a dude, and he'll pull you nice and tight, and he'll stick his forehead on you, look you dead in the eye, and he'll press noses and breathe. It's a great COVID kind of thing, right? Now, if you don't know that, and you go to a Maori village, and a guy comes up to you, you're visiting, guy comes up to you, and he grabs you by the shoulders, and he's pulling you close, you're like, oh my word. And he's kissing me. This man is gonna kiss me. And so the first time this ever happened to me, I grabbed his shoulders and I pushed him back. And all of a sudden he was like, ooh, you know, like, you're breaking the rules. And the guy with me said, no, that's the greeting. The women are gonna come kiss your cheek, and you're gonna press noses with all these guys, because the belief is if we can share breath, we're not enemies. I didn't know that. When I lived in Canada, you know, we Americans, we are very vocal at our sporting events. You've noticed this? So I watch baseball or basketball, and if you don't like the official in basketball or baseball in the United States, it is completely within the bounds for you to inform him of where he's wrong, right? It's kind of part of the culture. What are you doing, Blue? And so I grew up in that, and so I played lots of sports. When you're on the field or you're on the court and the ref doesn't say something, you're like, you missed that one, buddy. It's okay for you to talk, but in Canada, they're so polite that you don't say anything. If you go to a basketball game in Canada, it's almost silent because nobody will say anything to the referees. And if you do, they'll look at you like, what are you doing? You can imagine the American, fiery American showing up, and my kid's playing basketball, and he gets clearly fouled, but they don't call it. Stand up, what are you doing, ref? Echoes through the stadium, and they're staring at me like, what are you doing? Oh my goodness, you're the most hate. What in the world? I would watch baseball games, and you know, if an umpire, I learned after a while that you can't do this to umpires and stuff. And so we were at a tournament, and I got up and I started walking over to the bathroom. I was away from the field, and the chief of umpires was there. And I walked by him and I said, you guys have missed four, your umpire has missed four calls in a row, four 50-50s, and none of them have gone our way. That's all I said. And I started walking to the bathroom, and he stops and goes, that's it. You're out of here. Like, we're in the middle of a field alone. You're out of here. I said, what are you talking about? And he ran over to the field, and he started going onto the field to stop the game until I left the premises. Woo! I was like, so we were at a game the other night, just as a side, we were at an HCA game the other night, watching the, and we were with some of the fans, and you guys were doing the American thing and just letting the referee have it. And I said to my wife, we were sitting there, oh yeah, this is great. And so I started joining in, that's right, Joel, whatever the ref's name was, and was saying, Joel, you're better than that. That's right, Joel. And I was like giggling. She grabs my arm and says, stop it, you're going to get kicked out. When you live cross-culturally or visit cross-culturally, it's just very normal for you to be odd. It's very normal for you to be odd. The goal, of course, when you live cross-culturally, is that you try to meld in after a time. Like, that's success if you meld into the culture after some time. For Peter, though, it is in no way success to meld in. Culturally, should you meld in? Yes, put your foot down. Stop yelling at the ref. But morally? Absolutely not. 1 Peter 2, he says, beloved, I urge you as sojourners and exiles to abstain from the passions of the flesh, which wage war against your soul. I know that the whole society around you is urging you to give in to the passions. That's the way they live. But you, as an exile, you got different rules. You're governed by a different king. Yeah, but I'll look stupid. Right. Because exiles look stupid sometimes. Christians should be different from the world around them. Do you guys, when I was young, I didn't like the Los Angeles Lakers at all, still don't. But AC Green was the name of a guy on their team. Back in the day when Magic Johnson and James Worthy, AC Green was one of the players on their team. After the games, I don't know if you know this, but like where the players exit the stadium will be lined with women who are, all they want to do is go home with one of the players. So if you've ever read anything about Magic Johnson, he had so many ridiculous sexual exploits. He even wrote a book about it. AC Green would walk through that crowd and turn away from every last one of them. He got interviewed several times, like, "What are you? This is in the 80s. What are you doing, AC Green?" People thought he was like in a zoo exhibit. Look everyone at the virgin in his native habitat. People would be like, "That's so weird." And it didn't stop with him. Tim Tebow comes along. And he says the same thing. He's a really good-looking guy, and all the ladies love him. And they're like, "Oh, I bet you get the ladies a lot." "No, I'm a virgin." "What? Oh, my word. How can you possibly?" What an idiot. Right. It's because he's in exile. My father-in-law became a missionary to Japan years ago. In the 1960s, and when he came home after seminary and he told his parents that we're going to go serve the Lord in Japan, his parents weren't Christian people at the time, and they looked at him like he had lobsters crawling out of his ears, and they said, "If you do this, you're going to ruin your children, you're going to ruin your life, you're going to ruin everyone. Nobody does this. They don't want you there. We don't want you there. This is the dumbest thing we've ever heard of, ever. Are you crazy?" Well, yeah, a little bit. A little bit. There's a guy in my church in Canada who every year would get audited by the CRA, it's the IRS of Canada. Every year he'd get audited. And the reason he would get audited is because the government did not believe it was possible or reasonable for somebody to give away that much money. So they would come along every year. He had a lawyer ready to go, tax lawyer. Every year they'd come along and be like, "This is wrong, this amount of money. I know we came to you last year, but you can't give away that much money." Okay. His accountant even at points was like, "Are you crazy?" Yeah, a little bit. Which leads to a really important question. You crazy? Like, seriously, if there's nobody around who can tell the difference between you and everyone else around you, morally speaking, I don't know. Maybe the thing that you profess that you are, you're not. And I'm not asking how you feel. Well, sometimes I feel crazy. Sometimes I feel like I don't fit in. I'm not asking that. What I'm asking is, if I went and I asked the people who are around you, and they said, your comrades at work, or your friends on your team, or your neighbors, or whatever it is, you have a sphere of influence, and all of those people look in on you. Those who don't believe what you believe, they look in on you. Would they say, "Yeah, they're a little bit crazy"? It seems like they're chasing values that the rest of us aren't. Listen to me, that's normal. That's what it means to be a normal Christian. So we're exiles. But we're also elect. So here. Here's the last part of this passage. We'll start at the beginning again. Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to those who, and I want to deal with this word now, elect exiles of the dispersion in Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, Bithynia. The word elect is a word that lots of people shy away from whenever they want to talk about it because it's loaded with theological significance. But it's a word that shows up all over the New Testament to describe the Christians. It's basically a synonym for Christian. In places that the biblical authors, you expect them to use the word Christian, they oftentimes will use the word chosen or chosen one. So I'll give you several examples of this. At the beginning of Paul's letter in Titus, he says, "Paul, a servant of God and an apostle of Jesus Christ, for the sake of the faith of God's elect." It would be normal for you to say, for the sake of the faith of Christians, right? But he calls them God's elect and their knowledge of the truth. Colossians, Paul again, Colossians 3. Put on then as God's chosen ones, you expect Christian, as Christians, or as God's children, holy and beloved, compassionate hearts, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience. But he uses chosen ones as a synonym. This is in this passage is in 1 Corinthians. But God chose what is foolish in the world to shame the wise. Notice this, he did not choose the wise. So there's a group, and out of the group, he chooses the foolish and leaves the wise. That's the image. God chose what is weak in the world to shame the strong. God chose what is low and despised in the world, even things that are not, to bring to nothing things that are. So here's God. He's choosing out of a group the weak, the foolish, and leaving the wise. John 15, you did not choose me, but I chose you, and I appointed you that you should go and bear fruit and that your fruit should abide. He's talking about salvation here, guys. So this concept creates all sorts of challenges for people. Because it leads to the question, all right, look, the Bible seems to clearly use this language of elect. On what basis is God choosing? Well, actually, 1 Peter tells you the answer to that question. What is the basis that God uses to choose? Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to those who are elect exiles of the dispersion, according to the foreknowledge of God. To the elect exiles, see, elect exiles, according to the foreknowledge of God the Father. Okay, what's that? So election is based on foreknowledge. What is that? Well, there's a couple ways you can go that way. A lot of people will say, well, see, that's God's. God looks down the quarters of time and he sees that if you choose him, he will choose you. So he foresees that. It's a fact about you that he foresees. Given a set of circumstances, you will choose him. Or the word foreknowledge has more of a relational sense. And I gotta tell you guys, this is the way the Bible uses the word. When it says Adam knew Eve, it doesn't say, well, he knew what was on her mind. He knew her he knew what her hair color was. He knew what she liked to eat for breakfast. No, it means he knew her in an intimate way. When it comes around to Amos chapter 3, for example, and Israel's described, listen to the way Israel's described, you only have I known of all the families of the earth. Yes, does God know things about the Babylonians? Absolutely. Does he know things about the Assyrians? Absolutely. But he doesn't know them like he knows Israel. He has a covenant love for them that he chose to show them. They didn't pick him, he chose them. And he chose to love them before they ever showed any love toward him. 1 Peter chapter 1, he, Jesus, was foreknown before the foundation of the world. He's not saying that God's like, yeah, gee, I know what Jesus is gonna do later on when he goes and he's incarnate on earth. It's no, the Father knows the Son. In fact, any time the language of foreknow or know is attached to a person, it means intimacy. Which means the basis then of God's election is for love. He chooses before the foundations of time, of history, to set his affection upon you, Christian. So if you go back to the passage and you put this whole thing together, You put this whole thing together, yeah. You get, they're chosen or they're elect exiles according to the foreknowledge of God, right? Who loved you before the foundation of the world in the sanctification of the Spirit. Got the Trinity coming along here. But that means that God in his, in due time, sanctification means set apart. He set you apart. So he predetermined that he was going to love you. And then in time, he sets you apart. The Spirit sets you apart, opens your eyes so that you can see the beauty of Christ, so that you would obey Jesus Christ, so that you would submit your life to Jesus Christ. Everything about your salvation was planned and executed and will be kept by the Trinity. Everything is of God. So in real terms, here's what that means. So I came to faith in Christ when I was in at a Christian camp, love camping. Came to faith in Christ when I was at a Christian camp. I remember where it happened. I was in this big building called the Forum, and they had these steps that, like this, that were, I always still remember it, they were carpeted with green shag carpet. Listen, it was like the early 80s, right? So these steps, and down at the bottom was where the guy would speak. And so I remember sitting at the top being bored, but the guy who was speaking was describing what Jesus went through when he died on the cross. And for some reason, although I'd never listened to this before ever in my life, I was entranced by what he was describing. Like I couldn't turn away from it. And I was overwhelmed by the sense that Jesus went there for me. I understood that that should be, I should receive judgment akin to that. But he took it for me. So, you know, at the end of the time, he we're going to pray now, he said, and while everyone's eyes are closed, he said, we can just slip your hand up in the air if you want to trust Jesus. And I was, my hand was immediately up. I was like, yep, that's me. I'm in. Okay, so I was there at the camp with this other guy, and he was sitting there next to me, and he was grabbing my arm saying, put your arm down. This is ridiculous. So in this moment, how do we explain my response and this guy's response? Well, I can explain my response. And if you put yourself at the time that you came to faith in Christ, I know it feels like, well, that just happened in this particular moment. But the thing that the Bible teaches is actually this moment is a culmination of God's plan from eternity past to eternity future. That God loved you. He chose to set his affection upon you. And then in your life, he has orchestrated circumstances in just such a way so that you would come to faith in him at a particular time when he called you and the Spirit set you apart. And then you submitted your life to Jesus because you couldn't turn away from the beauty that is him. And then Jesus will keep you in the Spirit for the rest of your life until you finish this life. And then for eternity, you will look back and say, it was not me. Amen. So look, there are all sorts of election objections and issues, and I get it. I'm very happy to engage with that. We do that in our theology classes and stuff. But instead of arguing about the truthfulness of it, can we just for a minute get what Peter's trying to give us? He's trying to encourage us. He's trying to say, you know how you can live in a world that doesn't like you? Do you know how it is that you can live in a world that turns you away, that doesn't affirm you, but rejects you? You need to know that you're an exile, yes, and that you have a home that's not here. And number two, it doesn't matter what they think anyway, because the opinion about you is settled in the mind of God. So we have passages that really go after this, the book of Romans. And we know, Romans 8:28, that for those who love God, all things work together for good. For those who are called according to his purpose. That nothing in your life is going to happen to you that will not work together ultimately to serve God's eternal good for you. Planned from ages past to ages future. You know why I say it's planned from ages past to future? Because that's what Paul says. For those he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his son in order that he might be the firstborn among many brothers. And those whom he predestined, he also called. And those whom he called, he also justified. And those whom he justified, he also glorified. You see that right there? That's a past tense. No one here is glorified. I know you. You know me. When you walk by Jeff, you're like, now there's a glorified dude. Nope. But the fact that God has made this happen in eternity past to eternity future, and he stands outside of time, to him it is a past tense. It's settled. It's done. It's happened in the mind of God, and you're just living out the reality of it happening. Look, this is such a beautiful passage. For those who God foreknew, foreloved, he also predestined, and those he predestined, he also called. Those he called, he justified, and those he justified, he also glorified. There's nobody who is foreknown or predestined or called who is not glorified. If you are a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ, you are a believer because God made it so, and he will make it so forever. So your encouragement is supposed to be, yeah, I face all sorts of difficulties and challenges in this life, but when I realize God's eternal plan, all of the things happening to me are fitting within this framework. He has a purpose for every last one of them to serve my eternal good and his purpose. Every last one. And so when Christian people like you and me start to embrace that and feel it deep in our souls, here's what we do. We say along with Paul, next verses from this one, what then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? And the answer is, ain't nobody. Ain't nobody can be against us. He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things? That's not a new car. It's not a new bike. It's not what, all things pertaining to your eternal salvation. Who shall bring any charge against God's, what is it? Elect. No one will. We are more than conquerors through him who loved us. Oh, man. Look, even if we feel like we have no home in this world, we have a home with God. No matter how bad the suffering and persecution get, the most important issues for us have already been settled. What God wants to do with you in the book of 1 Peter is to grab you by the face like his adopted child who's quivering and shaking because everything's going on around them. And he wants to look you deep in the eyes. And he wants to say, you're mine. You were mine from the beginning. And you will be mine forever. We are elect exiles. Let me pray. Father, for your grace, I'm thankful. Listen, I know that we have all sorts of fights and debates about some doctrine in the church, but God, I pray that the debates would fade away so that we can see what Peter's trying to do here and encourage us in ways that we desperately need the encouragement. Father, I pray that the effect of this knowledge would be that we would, knowing that God is going to keep us, that we would then work to be kept, that we would serve you faithfully, and that we continue boldly, even though people look at us like we're crazy people for holding the viewpoints we do about moral things. I pray, Lord, that we would stand firm, and with Daniel, not bow down to the idol. Fill our hearts, Spirit. You who set us apart and gave us a heart to believe and submit to the authority of Jesus, would you, Spirit, come and fill us so that we can obey him from now until he comes, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Man, would you stand as we respond? You have a faithful, good God who's way better to us than we deserve.
Hallelujah. fills me. And all my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
About it, our God is good, and he is great, and he loves you. How amazing is that? That the God of the universe chose you and knows you and loves you and will never stop loving you. It means that nothing that he ever does in your life could be bad for you. It's all good for you because he's that committed to you. It means that whatever you're walking through right now, whatever is going on in your life, God has uniquely planted you there for your good. Now, we know that some of those things that God allows in our life can be hard and can test us and drive us to our knees and not know what to do next, and we need people to come around us and help us. And so if you're in the middle of something that's just a little too heavy, a little too tough to carry on your own right now, we have people who would love to pray with you. Just come to the front, have somebody pray with you and to remind you that God is working out his good plan in your life. If this is your first time here at Harvest Bible Chapel, would love to meet you, would love to answer any questions you might have about our church, so come meet me and some of our staff out the welcome area. And then if you want to give to our special offering for this month, there will be ushers at the doors, and please say hi to the people at Life Choices in Naomi's house in the lobby and HCA as well. But for all of you who are going about your week and being reminded, God has uniquely planted me. There's a reason that I'm here. There's a reason I'm going through what I'm going through. And you're on mission for Jesus. Remember that you are loved.